Imagine that you have a set of trees. No, not these ones, you nerd, real trees. And you want to surround them by using as less fence as possible. What you need to do is to find the convex hull of your set of trees. The convex hull of a set of points is the smallest convex polygon that contains all the points. Convex polygon means that all interior angles are less than or equal to 180 degrees. With our example, points represent trees and the borders of our polygon represent fence. And given the positions of our elements, we have different algorithms to find the convex hull. Today, we will see one of them, the Jarvis March algorithm, also called the gift wrapping algorithm. In this algorithm, we will find the first point of the hull, then the second one, then the third one, and so on until we close the convex hull by finding the first point again. For the first point, is the one that is as left as possible, because if we don't put it in the hull, there will be no other point before it to extend the convex hull enough to contain it. So for the first point, we just search for the point with the smallest x-coordinate. But what about the second one? Imagine that we assume that this point will be the next point in the hull. Then when we keep traversing the points, we find this one. Remember that our convex hull should surround all the points. And what we can do to include both of these points is to take both of them in the hull. But we can also directly take this one, because when we close the convex hull, you can see that the other point is included, so it works. And remember that we want to minimize the number of points in the hull, so it's better to take this one only instead of both of them. Okay, now this point becomes the new potential next point, but we didn't finish traversing the points. We keep traversing the points and we found this one. Once again, instead of taking both of them, we can just take this one. The other one will be included at the end, so this one becomes the new potential next point. We continue traversing and we found this point. Does it become the new potential next point? No, because if we do, this one won't be included at the end. We don't get a valid convex hull, so this one remains the potential next point. Okay, but why sometimes we updated next point and sometimes we didn't? The answer is that it depends on the orientation. Let's go back to the beginning. We assume that this point is the next point and we found this one. If we draw a line that goes from on hull to next point, then from next point to point, we can see that the orientation of the three points is counterclockwise. And when the orientation is counterclockwise, we deduce that by taking the third point in our hull, the second point will be covered, so the third point becomes the new potential next point. Then when we find another point with which the orientation of on hull, next point, and point is counterclockwise, we update again. Then, for example, with this point, we didn't update. The reason behind it is that now the orientation is not counterclockwise, it's clockwise. And when it's not counterclockwise, updating would result in a convex hull that doesn't surround the previous next point, which is wrong. This process looks like the process of finding the minimum in an array. We assume that the first element is the minimum, then for each element, if it's smaller, we update, it becomes the new potential minimum. Else, we don't update. In our algorithm, we assume that the first point is the next point to be on hull, then for each point, if the orientation of on hull, next point, and point is counterclockwise, point becomes the new potential next point. And by the way, on hull represents the last point added to the hull, is the point from where we will draw the next line. Okay, now we found the next point to be on the hull, we add it, it becomes on hull. Now, we need to find the third point of the hull. What do? Same process. We assume that the first point is the next point to be on hull, then for each point, if the orientation of on hull, next point, and point is counterclockwise, point becomes the new potential next point. We found the next point, we add it to the hull. Fourth point, same thing. Fifth point, same thing. Basically, we keep doing that until we found the first point again. It means that we close the hull, we return the array of points that we found. And this is how the Jarvis March algorithm works. We find the leftmost point, we put it on the hull, and we start. While we didn't find the initial point again, We assume that the first point in the array of points is next point, then for each point, if the orientation of on hull, next point, and point is counterclockwise, point becomes a new potential next point. After the loop, we add next point to the hull and it becomes the new on hull. Before moving to the code or something, we first need to understand how to check if the orientation of three points is clockwise, counterclockwise, or collinear. Let's suppose that we have three 2D points P1, P2, P3. Their coordinates are x1, y1, x2, y2, and x3, y3. To identify the orientation of these three points, we compare the slope of the line that passes from P1 and P2, and the slope of the line that passes from P2 and P3. How to calculate the slope of a line that passes from two known points? To do so, we divide delta y by delta x. Delta y is the difference between their y2 minus y1, and delta x is the difference between their x2 minus x1. So the slope of the first line is y2 minus y1 divided by x2 minus x1, and the slope of the second line is y3 minus y2 divided by x3 minus x2. Now we can compare. If the first slope is smaller than the second one, the orientation is counterclockwise. It's like we have a slow line, then it gets faster. It's like we went to the left. Else, if the first slope is greater than the second one, the orientation is clockwise. It's like we have a fast line, then it gets slower. It's like we went to the right. Else, if the two slopes are equal, it means that the orientation is collinear. Our three points are on the same straight line. Instead of comparing two elements, we can check if their difference is positive, negative, or zero. For example, here the difference is second slope minus the first slope. y3 minus y2 divided by x3 minus x2 minus y2 minus y1 divided by x2 minus x1. We will check if this value is positive, negative, or zero. But let's simplify the fractions before. We have the numerator of the first one times the denominator of the second one minus the numerator of the second one times the denominator of the first one. We get y3 minus y2 times x2 minus x1 minus y2 minus y1 times x3 minus x2. The orientation depends on the sign of the value of this expression. Now, if this value is positive, it means that the second slope is greater. The orientation is counterclockwise. Else, if it's negative, it means that the first slope is greater. The orientation is clockwise. Else, if it's equal to zero, it means that the orientation is collinear. In code, we just extract x and y of each point, we calculate the difference, and if it's positive, we return 1, if it's negative, we return minus 1, and if it's equal to zero, we return 0. 1 means counterclockwise, minus 1 means clockwise, and 0 means collinear. Now we start writing our solution. First of all, we found the leftmost point, the one that has the smallest x. Our points are represented by tuples of two elements, and the first element is the x coordinate, so we can just search for min points. After it, we create the hull, and we start looping. We keep looping while true, but we will have a condition to break the loop, don't worry. We add on hull to the hull, then we start searching for the next point. We assume that the first point is the next point, then we traverse points. For each point, we start by calculating the orientation of on hull, next point, and point. It can be minus 1, 0, or 1. Then, we check if we update next point. We update when the orientation is counterclockwise, 1. But also when the actual next point is the last one we added to the hull. We shouldn't add a point that is already on the hull. We write, if next point is equal to on hull or orientation equal to 1, we update. Next point receives point. After the loop, we now found the next point. We give it to unhull because it's the new last point that gets added to the hull. Also, we have the loop condition here. We said that we stop when we found the first point again. So if unhull is equal to the first point, we break. After the while loop, we just return the hull we made. But what if the three points are collinear? We said that we want to minimize the number of points on the hull, so if we found that the orientation is collinear, point becomes the new next point if it's farther from on hull than the actual next point, because by doing so, we still cover both of them by taking only one of them. In code, we update when on hull is equal to next point, when the orientation is counterclockwise, But now, also when the orientation is collinear and the distance from on hull to point is greater than the distance from on hull to next point. Dist is a function that calculates the Euclidean distance between two points. What about the time complexity? For the time complexity, finding the minimum point costs n, the number of points, and the outer loop keeps looping while we didn't find the first point again, and we're adding one point per iteration. So the number of iterations is equal to the number of points in the hull. Let's name it h. And the inner loop is traversing the n points. Remaining operations are in O of 1, we get n plus n times h, which gives an O of n times h time complexity, where n is the total number of points, and h the size of the hull. And for the space complexity, we have h for the hull, we get an O of h space complexity. The problem with the solution is that, in the case where all points are in the hull, h is equal to n, so we get an O of n squared time complexity, which is slow. This is why in the next video, we will see a more optimized algorithm, the Graham's Can algorithm. See you next week.